Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 41 of MagicFM. I'm Gaby Sparks, one of your hosts today, and I'm joined by Mashi Scanlon. As always, Mashi, welcome.
Hey, Gaby, how are you doing?
I'm good. I'm having a very nice Friday. How about you?
I'm doing pretty well. Yeah, it sounds like you guys had some delicious brisket last night.
We did. Yeah. Oh, my gosh, it was so good.
And everything.
So Luis, I think we've talked about this on the podcast, but Luis got a smoker and he's honestly in rare form with a smoker. He's just so happy. It's like his baby. He's using a baby monitor to like monitor the temperatures of it. Like it's to that level, you know?
I saw that.
But he just like loves making brisket. And I think he just generally loves feeding people. Like that's one of his love languages. So He loves taking care of his friends. He remembers people's coffee orders. It's like that sort of thing. So making barbecue is one of like his favorite things because he gets to make it all at once and then people get to have delicious barbecue. So we were making fun of burnt ends because every time we try to order them from a restaurant, they never have them. They're always sold out.
Yeah,
and the reason that's usually the case is because you make it with like a smaller part of the brisket. So you make a lot less burnt ends than you do regular brisket. And but he decided that he wanted to try to turn, like he found a recipe that could turn regular brisket into burnt ends. Like there was a recipe to just do that. So we're like, finally, we're all going to be able to have burnt ends. And I've never had them before. So I was so excited.
Oh, wow.
I know, literally never had them. So I'm like stoked about this. And then it's like 4 o'clock yesterday because it was basically the only other house we see is Casa Nasty, the people at Matt Nasty's house. And they're the ones that were coming for our D&D session. So it's like 5 o'clock and Luisa's, you know, messages our group chat and says, I know we were joking about how there's never burnt ends, but we're actually going to be short burnt ends because one of the briskets he was cooking was taking so long to heat up to like be warm, like hot enough. That he wasn't going to have enough time to turn it into burnt ends. So we ended up being short burnt ends again.
Oh my God. Come on, Luis.
Yeah, it was so good though. It was amazing. I'd never had them before.
Oh, I love burnt ends. Burnt ends are great. They are literally, if I go to a barbecue place and I see it as a special on the menu, immediately I'm like,
you just get them?
Because, well, normally it's like you get, you know, a one meat, two meat, three meat platter. And it's like, I immediately know, okay, that's going to be one of the meats I get for sure.
Yeah. Oh, from now on, I think I'm going to try to get burnt ends whenever I go to a barbecue place. I'd never had them. And whenever I tried to get them, they're always sold out. So I was just like, I don't even know if these things are real. Like they seem like a mythical thing that people tell me about.
Totally. So I see your hair tied back. My hair is getting pretty long. I'm getting that quarantine hair.
Oh, back in the quarantine right hair life.
Yeah. How are you doing with that? Cause you're tied back. So I can't tell.
So it's actually fine. I cut my hair like very, very short. It was like all the way down here. So I cut it all the way here. It's way more manageable. Mm. It's up right now just because it's kind of hot today, so I'd rather just put it up, but it's been okay. I did end up going to get a haircut. It was like a month ago now, and so it was all good, and they were very socially distant at the salon, but my plan is to just not get a haircut for a long time now, so how about you?
I did get in there for a haircut, but I think the window is closed now in California, so I don't think I'm going to be able to do it again.
Not for a while,
but it was
right?
crazy. This barbershop, which is just like, it's a really small place. It's like some dude owns it. He was a stylist somewhere else. I guess he got some money and he opened this little tiny three chairs. They play, like they serve you alcohol. They play hip hop, 90s
hip
hop all the time. So, and it's just like, it's all guys cutting hair there. And it's just hilarious because like, I tried to walk in there. I'd made an appointment and they like stopped me. And then they like took my temperature. I had to do all this stuff. There were all these rules. And it was crazy. So I was like, okay, wow, they took it really, really seriously. But I think they closed down again. So now
I think you're probably going to have to wait. That's really cool, though.
That's a
cool concept for a hair salon, too.
Oh, it was great. I mean,
because you just want to go, hey, at that point, like, just make it a thing, right?
The best part is, Gabby, the most of what they serve is whiskey. They have beers there. There's a fridge in there, and it's mostly whiskey. And a lot of people bring whiskey as gifts. Like, you can bring a bottle there as a gift. Yeah. And it's just hilarious. It's 9 a.m. on a Saturday. And as I'm walking there, like, oh, by the way, no refreshments right now. I'm like, it's 9 a.m. on Saturday. I don't need a whiskey. Guys, like, I'm good.
Yeah.
So I was like, I don't know. Totally, I get it.
That's really awesome, though. I've been to a couple hair salons that offer you, like, mimosas or wine when you're getting a haircut. And it's just like, yeah, why not? I'm just sitting here doing nothing. So
yeah, why not? Why not? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh my gosh. All right. Before we dive in, Gabby, we got so much exciting stuff.
We have
joining our podcast family and other things. Yeah, bring us into it, Gabby.
All right, we've got a few exciting announcements. So we didn't talk about this last week. It did actually kind of kick into effect last week. But I did want to let people on the podcast know that I started being Channel Fireball's influencer manager. Yay!
It was awesome.
It's been great. Stuff. It's really been awesome. And it's been very cool to kind of start to work with everybody that works with CFB, you know, all of our affiliates, our content producers and stuff like that. And this has also meant that there's been a lot of exciting announcements going on in the Twitter universe. And I was actually making the joke that finally 2020 delivered some good news because we brought on some awesome content producers to Channel Fireball. And some of this was, you know, born out of, you know, me coming on to CFB. We brought two awesome, awesome personalities onto Channel Fireball. One of them is Jana Amari, who was our guest 2 weeks ago, and she was awesome. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of our listeners loved having her on. She was just great, and she's going to be starting to produce content for CFB, so you have that to look forward to. You can find that all on channelfireball.com. And then the second group of folks, actually, because it's two of them, is Mr. Metronome and Lord Tupperware, aka Ethan Sachs and Ben. I don't know how to pronounce his last name, actually, but it's Ben.
I just know Ethan and Ben.
It's Ethan and Ben from Lords of Limited are actually joining the CFB family as well. So that means that Lords of Limited is coming over to the network of CFB podcasts. And that also means that they will be producing content, writing content, and making videos for channelfireball.com. So
yeah.
All those announcements went live today. It's been awesome to see the community reaction. And it's just been cool because I'm one of the people behind the scenes kind of facilitating these things happening. So great stuff. It's been very, very cool. We would love to give them a super warm welcome.
Welcome to the family.
Yeah.
Welcome to the family. It's awesome.
Along with that, there's also a new thing that we are going to start promoting here on MagicFM is that we have an affiliate code now. This is one of the things that I got brought on to CFB to do, which is work on our affiliate program. So instead of using the code Gabby, now if you would like to support this podcast, you should use the code MagicFM, MagicFM. Easy peasy. Name of the podcast.
That's it. Yeah. Hard to forget.
And what this does is it's a way to directly support your content creators. And this isn't just true for CFB. This is true for anyone out there that has a CFB affiliate code. It is not a discount code. It is a code that you can use to support those streamers. It directly supports them, YouTubers, anyone that has a CFB affiliate code. You will directly
streamers,
support them.
Authors, everyone. It goes directly
authors,
back to them.
Yeah. Anyone. Mm-hmm. Goes directly back to them. And it is also a way for you to let Channel Fireball know that you want to support their content. It's a way of letting them know that you like their stuff and you want to show them some love. So if you would like to support this podcast or any other Channel Fireball affiliate, if you're already shopping on channelfireball.com, remember, use that code. It's complete free roll for you and it really helps your streamers, YouTubers, and podcasters out.
Gabby, now that you're in-house and the influencer manager and working with Channel Fireball, I can tell you the real reason we wanted you for this role. Mm. Slowly, your influence and power is growing with things like Lords of Limited and Jana, and you're doing more and more with content. And eventually, one day, if we all work hard, we can slot Luis in under you. And you can be his boss. And that will be a great day for all of us in the Channel Fireball ecosystem. That is the goal.
Oh, man. Speaking of this, it's totally unrelated to magic, but I have to tell this story because it's so perfect for this. So,
oh my God, is this the D&D story?
It's the D&D story.
Oh my God, this story is amazing.
It's
yes, please
so
tell this story.
Funny. It's just, you said it right now and I was like, oh my gosh, I have to tell the podcast about this story now. So for those who don't know, I love Dungeons and Dragons. I've been playing it for a while and we have an awesome D&D group here in Denver. And Luis is our dungeon master. So he is basically the person who makes the story flow along. And anything that happens in the story is kind of up to him. Like, we can suggest lines of play. Lines of play doesn't really make sense for D&D. We can suggest things to do and which actions we want to take. And he kind of gets to decide, hey, this thing will happen in the game or it won't happen in the game. So my character in the game is this wizard, and wizards in D&D have the spell called Identify. So you can cast Identify to get the properties of a magical item. So we're in this tomb. We're playing this campaign called Tomb of Annihilation, and we're in this tomb that has a skull, a magical skull somewhere in there. And we're like trying to identify it, but we don't know what it is. So eventually we get brazen and we decide, I decide because I'm the person that has to identify it. I'm like, that's fine, whatever, I'll touch it. And touching things in D&D can be scary because it can kill you, things can explode, you can get cursed, like you never know. But I'm like, okay, I'll touch it. So I touch the thing. And what happens is this magical flying skull gets cursed upon me. And this is what it does. It's just, it's a fool. It's just annoying. All it does is it makes fun of us. That's all it does. And makes fun of our party and never does anything helpful. Doesn't provide any sort of information. It's just the peanut gallery. It's literally just someone who's now joining our party to be the peanut gallery. And Luis is the person who DMs this. So
Luis has just joined your party.
So basically he just joined the party. So obviously, you know, he tweeted about it today. He says, highlight of the D&D yesterday, the party found a magic golden skull named Yaka, and the first person to touch it was Gabby. She now has a sarcastic, annoying skull floating along her until they use a wish or feed it an undetermined amount of gems, which means I'm having a ball. If we feed it an undetermined amount of gems, it will eventually go away. We just have no idea how much it is. So basically we just had Luis, the real person, join our campaign a little thing that's just floating near me, always like saying nonsense stuff and being a fool around me. So it was like, my life is just my D&D character is just real life.
Can everyone in the party hear it? Or can I mean, I know everyone can saying hear it to everyone.
Everyone can hear it. Yes. The entire campaign yesterday, everything we did, it would just kept making fun of us because we were like, whenever we were being like kind of cowardly or something, Yaka would just chime in and be like, oh, you're being cowardly, that's why you didn't want to do that. And we're like, yeah, okay, sure, thanks for calling it out.
Oh my gosh. So okay, let me ask this, was this just all a setup for you? Like, he knew you were going to be the one that was going to have to be the first to touch it?
I don't think so. I think Yaka was set up to come and be a thing. Like, Yaka was just going to join the party and it could have followed anyone, but it just happened to follow me.
Oh my God.
It was absurd.
Unbelievable. Do want to ask this, because I don't play D&D. Are you certain there isn't an upside use for Yaka later in this campaign?
There really has not been so far. It's the most useless. The whole thing is that it's just like a quartz fool. Like, so far has provided zero information, nothing useful, just criticism, mockery, and sarcasm. That's all
it is. So it is just Luis.
Yes. So I'll include useful, the link to his tweet on the show notes. I can do that because all the comments on it are so funny. Everyone's just like,
it is such a setup. Yeah, it is such a setup. Yaka, yaka, yaka.
Yeah. If you've ever played The Legend of Zelda, I guess it's kind of like Navi from that. It's like as useless as Navi. Basically, that's what we picked up during this campaign. So,
well, I think someone mentioned this in the tweet, but it really sounded like Bob from the Dresden Files to me. Yes. Although Bob is like incredibly useful. Bob is like a resource. Sarcastic, but a resource. It sounds like Yaka, you get all the bad and none of the
and
good.
None of the helpfulness. Yes. It was Pat Cox was saying, like, is this him? I'm like, yeah, except imagine that it's not useful at all. And instead it's just kind of taking up space.
Again, just like Luis.
Yeah.
So you're gonna be able to tee off on this Yaka being just Luis with all these negative comments directed towards Yaka. And then anyone can just follow up by going, oh yeah, just like Luis. It's going to be brilliant. You need to turn the tables on this, Gabby.
For real. It was funny because Luis knew he opened himself up to get made fun of because it's this annoying, sarcastic character and all he wants to do is eat. He's like, well, it is a lot like me. Pulls that collar.
Yeah. It literally is. So, oh my gosh. Okay. So that from Luis's predatory DM actions to, potentially predatory actions on the part of wizards. I have strong feelings on this, but we should talk about it because I know the community has really strong feelings about the open. This last weekend we had the historic open on Arena, but it's just kind of like the open structure, how it works. So for those who don't know, the way Magic Arena runs these tournaments is you play day one. Day one's always best of one. Day two is always best of three. And day one is what, 4,000 gems? And you can, I think it's 4,000. And you can enter as many times as you like.
I don't remember exactly how many. I know the payout on day two, which is if you get to 6 wins, you get 1K, 7 wins is 2K. And before that, sometimes you get gems. If you qualified into day two.
Right. And you can put the whole trick with day one, and I'm pretty sure it's 4,000. I'm just going to say that. I'm sure someone will let me know if I'm wrong.
Sure.
Is you can pay that 4,000 gems as many times as you want. Your goal is to get 7 wins before 3 losses. But if you pick up those 3 losses early, you can just immediately jump back in the queue and keep playing and grinding. Now, that's on you. You know, your choice. I mean, you don't have to do any of that. But Wizards has come under fire from certain people saying, hey, that's just a totally predatory system. And I think for those of you who have not listened to Constructed Resources, if you play Constructed Magic, you should be. It's really great. It's an awesome, awesome podcast. I will say, obviously, I love Luis. We all know Luis. Luis's input in there is great. He's very fun. But the real information source, to be honest, and Luis is still a great source of information, is BK. His insights and analysis of the metagame post-ban, what cards to look at, how he looks at cards is so deep and so good. I was shocked. Like, I know BK, I don't know him that well, but like listening to him, I'm like, oh my God, the expert is really BK. Like, I really think Luis is like,
yeah,
the host.
He does a really, really good job, I think, communicating all that stuff. BK's just all up to date with all this stuff. And I think he's never really had because he hasn't made that much content before. He's never really had an avenue to kind of like display that. And I think people that are now listening to it are like, whoa, like kind of taken aback because they didn't expect how. And I'm not saying this is a beat. It's just like he's so good and natural at it. Unknown. And he's never really had an avenue for it before.
Yeah. And I say this having just, I just listened to like, I think I jammed 3 of the 4 episodes yesterday because I was out running errands. I just had it in my ears. So it was great. It's wonderful. It's got a great back and forth. And despite how wonderful I think and how necessary, like not just good, but necessary it is to listen to their stuff if you want to do construct, if you want to play Constructed, the best thing I have heard on that podcast was BK's closing last week, where he addressed this, or I guess it was this week, pardon me. He addressed this specific issue and he did it wonderfully, and to the point where I'm like, Gabby's like, we should talk about this. I'm like, we should, but kind of like the best statement out there.
BK's statement was the best, but I think the thing that I wanted to open up a discussion here about and to kind of let other people weigh in on it, you know, like people that listen to Magic FM, is people have just been wondering, what is Wizards' responsibility when they create a tournament structure that looks like that? That's the big question, right? Because some people are saying, yo, this feels predatory to me, you shouldn't make it at all. And some people are saying, hey, this isn't predatory at all. It's kind of on the person to decide when they want to stop joining, because it does have this little element of like a roulette where you can join. And if you did bad, you can join. And if you did bad, you can join. And you can just keep going and going and going, right? And we all know that slot roulettes are made to be addictive. Like, they make you want to keep going and going and going. So the question is, how do we feel about Wizards making an event that allows this, right? An event that you can just join as many times as you can within the time window, where there's no way, there's no stopping you. Like, if you just want to keep and qualify, you can join and join and join. And you could, who knows how much money you could sink into this, into doing that. And
I think it's like, I think it's, if 4,000's right, I think it's about 25 bucks per entry. So that's what it costs. And so the 4 entries, you're $100 in, right? Like, I mean, you can, it can get out of hand pretty quickly. I will give you that. So, but the question of what is the responsibility? And I mean, I don't know how many app games you play or other like quote unquote free to play games you play. It'll start pinging you like, oh, hey, you're dead. Do you want to buy X more lives for this much money? Or, hey, you stop playing. Do you want to do this? Like those apps start blowing up your phone saying, hey, you still got a game going here. Don't lose your progress. You can keep playing, blah, 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 blah. And that to me is so much more predatory. This is very passive. This offer is out there. I mean, could you imagine, what if it was like this, Gap? It's like, oh, you picked up your 3rd loss. You can keep your current record. Just give us 4,000 more gems. You have one win. You keep those five wins.
You would just basically keep paying until you got there. Like, you would just keep re-rolling every time, right?
Right. Because, I mean, if you have 5 wins and 3 losses, the 4,000 gems at that point, you're like, oh, crap, well, it's a no-brainer. I better do it, right?
Yeah. So I guess if we want to quantify it, there is the like least pay to win or like pay to play, and then the most, right? So the least would be you join at one time, you only get one shot, and if you don't get it, you don't get it, right? That's the way most Magic tournaments work, and that would be the least, I think, because it's just your chance. You're taking one shot, you got one shot, and that's it. That's how a lot of the qualifiers work, right? You get one qualification. If you make top 1,200, you get to run it one time. And if it works out, great. And if it doesn't work out, try again next month. Yep. The most would be what you just gave as an example right now. Like, hey, we noticed that you would be out unless you wanted to re-roll your record. Would you like to try one more time for 4,000 gems? That would never fly. People would be so unbelievably upset because it's so, it would be just so transparent, right?
Yeah, it's awful, yeah.
But like, where does the current structure, where does that land? Is it, because a lot of people think it's bad. And I don't personally think it's bad. I don't think it's Wizards' responsibility to kind of babysit all of its players, right? I think to some degree, the people playing it, I mean, it's not even fair to say that all the people playing it should be adults because Magic is a 13 plus game.
13 plus.
Right. So,
but these events, I think, I'm not sure about the Arena Open. Is there an age limit for the Arena Open? Because they're paying out cash.
Let me see if I can find one.
I think it might be a 16.
You must be 18 years or older to participate.
18.
Yeah.
So there you go. Now, obviously, there's ways to cheat that, right? But that's a good rule. And so, like, if younger people are playing it, that's one discussion. If you're 18 or over doing this, like, what responsibility does Wizards have to that age bracket? And what do they have? What responsibilities do they have to the younger bracket? Or in that sense, gatekeeping, keeping those younger players out of these events? That's the real question, right? Because they're designing this very specifically for 18 plus because of the prize money. There's $1,000 or $2,000 attached, and there's a lot of legal yada yada that they have to deal with by doing that.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I don't know what the line is. The reason I wanted to have the discussion is because I wanted to try to see if we could figure out what the line is. I know that the way it is structured right now, when I saw it, I thought it was fine. And then when people started complaining about it, I was like, huh, I wonder if there's more to this that I didn't think about. Like, that's kind of what brought this discussion to me. It was seeing other people think like, oh, this is really weird. Why do you just let people continue to try to reroll? That seems like it's toxic. Like, that seems predatory. And I don't know how much Wizards has a responsibility to do that. Like, what do you think?
I don't think they do. I think that this is benign enough. It's what I was trying to say in the beginning is it's very passive. The client is not pushing you to join it. It'll pop up in the slider. That's fine. Nobody objects that, I don't think. But it doesn't really push you to rejoin if you've already played. You know, I think about myself. So like, for instance, for me, I love ice cream. And I know I struggle if I have a pint of Ben and Jerry's, it's very hard for me to like open that pint and not eat the whole thing in one sitting.
Sure.
That's just, I love it. So I don't buy Ben and Jerry's. Like I can't let it get that far. So I get that about myself where I'm like, I don't want to buy myself that Ben and Jerry's and tell myself, oh, I'll just have a little bit at a time. Cause I know what's going to happen. So when I buy it, I go, okay, that's great. I know this is going to happen. When it comes to things like the Arena Open, I played in the standard one a month and a half ago. And all I did with that, this was easier than ice cream for me, is I said, I'm going to give myself two bullets. That's it. And I scrubbed out after the second one. I'm like, that's it. And I stopped. And maybe that's too much to ask of the player base. But
So let's use that example. Let's use your exact same example. So you said, man, I know I buy Ben and Jerry's. And if I have it at home and I open it, I'm just going to eat it all. You learn that because you've done that. Clearly, at some point, you open a pint of Ben and Jerry's and you were like, oh, surely I'll only eat half. And then you get to the bottom and you're like, oh my gosh. So you had to go through this learning experience, right? You had to learn like, hey, maybe it's not a good idea for me to have a pint of Ben and Jerry's at home, or maybe I should just get a cone when I'm out, because if I have it at home, I'm just going to finish it. Like, it's a little different with Ben and Jerry's because it's just a product you buy at a store, right? There's no like pay to play or like pay to win aspect. Like, you either get ice cream or you don't. But in this case,
I can't instantly get more.
Right. And you can't instantly, like, it's not a like, do it again and do it again and do it again. But that is something you can do with this entry. And is it bad that Wizards gives that option to people? Like, is it reasonable to expect an 18-year-old to be able to do that?
I think so. I think it's okay. I don't think it's bad to give that option to people. I don't know. And I actually don't even know if we don't think 18-year-olds are able to do that. Okay. That's discussion. That's a discussion. The other discussion is, should it be catered to the 18-year-olds? Should it always be like with the 18-year-olds in mind? Should all these structures take into account what we think the worst behavior is, and then try to build itself up as much as possible to protect against the very, very worst, most degenerate behavior? And I don't think that's the right way to do it. I agree that we need to be sensitive to those things, but I don't think you can build a system with like how could this be the most predatory, the most abusive to that like lowest common denominator? I don't think that makes sense, or nor do I think that benefits the vast majority of us. Setting a number, like the one thing I was saying, because BK and Luis, when they talked about it, they were like, when it doesn't feel good anymore, when you feel like you have to keep going into it, and they go into sunk cost fallacy, which that's just a lie. You know, you get sunk cost fallacy, it's another thing.
Yeah.
Right. And so Google that, look it up on Wikipedia, just basically like, you know,
it's feeling priced into doing something because you already spent money doing something. Like,
right.
It's like if you,
and that,
go ahead, Mash.
I was gonna say like, the cost you've already spent are not relevant to your future decisions. The money you've spent, if it has no effect on the future, should not affect your decisions for the future. That's the big thing, right? That money is gone, or that resource is gone, and it should not affect how you make the next decision. That's the big thing. But we tell ourselves, oh, I've already spent this much in, I've already, you know, and in this scenario, you don't get those wins. They don't carry over. You don't, there's no reason for you to continue going.
Right.
It is just gone. So that's that, but I know I've told myself that. I've already said that. I've done that, you know, in magic, outside of magic as well. But I mean, what would it look like to be more protective? One is, okay, you only get one bullet. That's it. You could see a system where maybe in order to register for this event, this would be so bad for Wizards. Like, it'd be very tough. The only way you could play in this event multiple times is 24 hours in advance. You set a maximum. Like you said, okay, I'm going to give myself two bullets. I'm going to click this button on Arena and put my number in, and it's 2 or it's 5 or it's 10. But after that amount, Arena will shut me down. And if I don't put anything in, I only get one bite at the apple. That's a lot of work for them. And it seems not great. I mean, do you think that would be like going to that extreme is necessary?
I don't even know. I feel like that almost feels like babysitting, like to too big of a degree, right?
Yeah.
I guess I could see a world where they limited the amount of entries or like the amount of times you could try. Like they could say like you get to try 3 times and after the 3rd time we will not allow you to join anymore. Like I guess there's ways to get around that, right? Like somebody could just make another Arena account and join. But if you gotta
build a new deck.
I was going to say if it's standard or historic, you would have to have all the cards. So it's not even like that easy of an out. If they wanted to like really set a limit to it. I find it interesting because to make my position clear, I don't think what they did is predatory. I think most of the people that I saw engage with this tournament joined a few times and either got there or decided like, "Meh, that was like my 2nd time trying. I'm done." Or like, "That was my 3rd time trying and I just fell a little short. Now I just want to move on with my day and do something else. I'm done." But I certainly also have seen, and this is not related to the historic event, but Mash, I've met so many Magic players who I felt like Magic wasn't necessarily a good thing for them, where they to achieve greatness. They wanted to win their tournaments. They wanted it so much, and they would go to Grand Prix after Grand Prix, PTQ after PTQ, and just grind themselves down to nothing in pursuit of this. And it's like it almost would have been better if they just had never met it, like had never experienced Magic in the first place.
Sure.
And sure. I worry about like, what does a structure like this event do for players like that? That is where some of my concern is at. Like when people started pointing that out, I was like, you're right. I personally know some people that this has happened to, and it makes me wonder, I wonder if this is like a bad thing to exist because there are people that engage with it that way. And should Wizards even care?
So I'd like to suggest that this is a very tricky thing. And this is a great question, by the way. I love this question. This is really the heart of the matter. And it's like one of those things like, Mosh, you got to express yourself well here and not sound callous or stupid. One, I think what you're pointing out is someone who just forget the historic open or any open structure for a second. That is a person who has an unhealthy relationship with the game.
Right.
And when to call this structure predatory, I think you'd have to say, hey, the game manufacturer, in this case Wizards of the Coast, has knowledge of this whole swath of people that have this unhealthy relationship with the game, and they are intentionally creating this system to exploit those people. I do not think that's what happened here. I don't think there's any intent to exploit a player base. Now, what you're describing, I have seen this as well. And that is not about the Arena Open or any Open Series or GPs. That's someone who has a very unhealthy relationship with the game. Don't take it from someone who's just not who's like average at best at Magic, please don't ever tie your success to this game or any game to your self-worth. Because that's what I think is happening there. It's like, I am not good at Magic. I am not finding success in Magic. Therefore, I'm bad at Magic, or I'm bad at life, and I'm not finding success at life. Trust me, that's not the case. Trust me, that's not the case. And the best players, and by the way, the best players in the world at this game that I personally know have a healthy relationship with the game. They've had moments of unhealthy relationship with the game.
Absolutely.
Particularly right when you win that first Pro Tour or you win that first GP and then you're kind of chasing the dragon. You feel like, wait a minute, why am I going through a slump? I can't do it. And then you readjust and find that healthy relationship. And it's weird because when you find that balance, you will become better at the game, I think.
I think
what you're outlining is not a problem with the game, the structure though, right? Because it's not trying to exploit that specific thing.
Yeah, I agree. I guess this is a PSA for anybody out there who might need to hear this, because I've definitely been at different points in my Magic career where I felt better and worse about my relationship to Magic. And really, mm-hmm. it's been in a much, much upward trend in the last few years after I kind of let go about the fact that I didn't really care to be that competitive. Like, it took me a long time to kind of separate myself from that. And I think some of this happens because people in the Magic community so focus on results and so focus mm-hmm. on worth being tied to Magic accomplishments, and your self-worth and who you are as a person and your value as a person is not tied to those Magic results. And I know that it can be very easy to try to chase that because that is what people are putting out there. But I just think that's a very narrow way of looking at the world, because a person's made up of so much more than just their Magic results, like who they are as a person, what do they do for work, what do they do for fun, their hobbies, what kind of friend they are, what are their interests, what are their passions, what things they've done that better the world. And Magic results are great, but they're such a small drop in the bucket compared to like what makes an entire person. So if you ever feel like you're getting too tied down, too bogged down into like, I have to do this because if I don't do this, then I'm going to feel like I'm not good, just stop for a second and know that you can separate yourself from that and that your self-worth is not tied to those results. And I think that if more people internalize that as in the Magic community as a whole, I think we'd have less of this, I have to join again, I have to join again, I have to join again, because people wouldn't feel so prey, not prey, but so like in need to get those results.
They wouldn't need the reassurance.
Yes.
They wouldn't need the validation. Don't let this game, don't let any game. I mean, that's not where you draw your validation from.
Yeah.
Hopefully you get it internally, but if you got to get it externally, the people you love, the people around you. You know, I have dogs, so it's really easy for me. I just look down, everything you're saying is so true, Gabby. We've seen this, right? If this isn't just average players, there's pro players who go through this too. If you are around the pro scene, if you go to Grand Prix, if you are in any tournament circuit, if you go to your local game store, you can and will see this. And we've all been there. I mean, I'm telling you, the best tournament run I ever had was regionals in like 99. And I remember the exact play, naming the wrong card with Meddling Mage when I should have said Seal of Fire instead of Obliterate, that cost me that match. Like, that's how competitive minded I was at that time. And it's been years. And I remember putting it down, looking at my opponent and going, oh my God, I just named the wrong card. And what did he do? He dropped Seal of Fire, killed my Meddling Mage and took the game. So, you know, you get into that mindset. And I still beat myself up over that play. Years later, it doesn't matter how good I am at Magic, but I still think about it. So I know what that feels like. I really do. But think about the depth of the people around you that are, you know, whether it's me and Gabby and I, you know, where I take more joy out about hearing about Bernanz and Luis's brisket and his excitement, enthusiasm for that. I truly do, because I know Luis. And that's the dimension of Luis, like with food and everything. Despite all the commonalities, Magic TV and all this content we've made together, I feel more connected with Luis over food than I do, like, because he loves Vietnamese food. And I'm like, dude, check out this cool thing. I'll like Slack him like this awesome food I'm eating. And he'll be like, oh my gosh. And for everyone listening to this, for anyone who needs to hear that, think about your play group. Think about the people you play with. And think about maybe having pizza during playtesting, those moments, like talking about that stuff, how interested you are, how inspired and how much fun you have being part of that. That's the engagement, not the win-loss. I think that's so important. I look back on the times when I was competitive, and the players I played with and the people that I really got to know, and, you know, going to Denny's at 3 a.m, that's what I really take away from it. No, seriously though, right?
I know. I laugh because I've also done the Denny's at 3 a.m. sort of, yes.
Yeah. So I hope that's what you take away from it. But we're so far afield here. I don't really think it's predatory. And I know I gave a lot of examples of how it could be worse, and I hate using that as a metric. But ultimately, you know, selling booster packs, you know, should we be limiting that? Like, where does the line go? Like, should I say, hey, Gabby, I've noticed you bought a box in the last week. I don't think I should sell you any more packs.
Oh, my God. Or, like, drinks in a bar.
Right. I noticed you spent $100 in singles on ChannelFireball.com. I'm going to shut your account down for a week, and then you can come back. You know, at a certain point, it starts to get ridiculous.
Right. I also think it's different when people are using their money to buy product. It's like, you can't really be policing people's personal finances. If like they want to buy the stuff, they do it. It's
true.
Yeah. But overall, I think we're both kind of aligned. I think we're pretty aligned in that we don't think the structure is predatory. And I think maybe more of the takeaway is focus on having a good relationship with a game, so that when something like this comes along, you can... Like, I actually think it's cool that you get to reroll, because I've gone to so many PTQs that I went like 0-1 in the beginning of the run, and I would have given anything to reroll because we just drove like 2 hours somewhere near Chicago to go to this PTQ. And then it was like, oh, you started 0-1. And then, you know, the PTQ is of a size that you know that if you lost one, you're already out. And you're like,
yeah.
Oh, why am I even here? You know,
good luck everybody else. Yeah. The other thing I think is really important that we could probably just close on, unless you have more to say, Gabby, is the point that BK and Luis really made, that I think this was actually, BK had a great thing. Everyone should just listen to this, by the way. But one of Luis's benchmarks, which I think is really, really compelling, is ask yourself if you're still having fun. If you had fun with that first run, and then you did the second run, and it's a little bit less fun, and the third run feels like an obligation, and, you know, or whatever you're doing in Magic, the moment you have to check in and go, God, this is miserable, I hate this, or, oh my God, I gotta do this, take a step back. When it's not fun anymore, it's time to really reevaluate how you feel in that tournament, or maybe with the game in general. But it's you should be enjoying it. There's stress, there's tough decisions. That's part of the joy of Magic, right? Is those tough gameplay decisions. And there's a little bit of stress with that. You want to make the right play. That's okay. That's part of the fun. But when the whole thing is just like, and I've been there. I'm sure you've been there too, Gabby. You're just like, this is miserable. Ask yourself, hey, is this how it's supposed to be? So...
Yeah, I like it. That's a very good point to end that topic on. For the second topic today, we had some bans. Oh. We didn't just have some bans, Mashi. We had some bans. Like, there were so many that people were out there saying that they thought the announcement that came out on Wizards' website was fake. Like, some people thought that they got hacked. Because there were so many bans that they're like, there's no way these are real. I bet someone got access to make a WordPress post and they just made a joke post about everything they banned, because they banned so much stuff. So let's break it down, shall we?
Yes.
Let's go through... How about this? I'm going to list the entire ban list and then we'll go through each format.
Okay, hit us.
Okay, so announcement date, August 3rd, 2020. Standard. Wilderness Reclamation is banned. Growth Spiral is banned. Teferi Time Raveler is banned. Cauldron Familiar is banned. Pioneer. Inverter of Truth is banned. Kethys the Hidden Hand is banned. Walking Ballista is banned. Underworld Breach is banned. Historic. Wilderness Reclamation is suspended. Teferi Time Raveler is suspended. AKA being suspended is basically being banned. Brawl. Yeah. Teferi Time Raveler is banned. Effective date, August 3rd. And this was... This wasn't just shocking because this was such a big ban announcement. It also came out of nowhere, because Wizards has made it known that moving forward, if they wanted to make a ban announcement, they would give us a week in advance. And instead, they came in strong on Monday and they were like, surprise, everything's banned. No heads up, no sort of announcement. They were like, boom, here it is.
I love it.
Yeah, I honestly loved it too. I saw some people that didn't like it. I think there's obviously people who are going to like or not like that structure. I was all for it. I thought it was so good.
Heck yeah. Totally. Rip the Band-Aid off. Let's get going.
Yeah.
I don't like that warning period. So just I think that's a good question. I think we agree here, but let's just get it out there. Like, they have had a policy of announcing a week ahead of time, hey, there will be a ban announcement next Monday in Modern. This is the first time they've done this. How did you feel about just the philosophy of doing it this way versus the announcement of an announcement?
I don't like the announcement of an announcement. Like, I have seen some people make the argument of, what if somebody's wanting to play a deck in a tournament and they don't want to, they don't want their deck to be banned next week? Like, if you see an announcement coming, maybe it'll just know to hold off on that purchase before you make it. But honestly, what I think it does do is it gives this, it just like makes a freeze, I think, in the Magic community, because
it totally does.
The second you see it, you're like, oh, something's coming. Watch out. Let's better not play in anything. Better not buy anything. Better not do anything. Mm-hmm. It just like puts it in pause in a way that just that I don't love. So I'm all for them just coming in. And also, if they were planning on cleaning up shop, I am glad they came in with everything. Just like, do it all at once. If you're going to, mm-hmm. if you thought these cards were going to be a problem, which they have been for a very long time, just do it all at once. We have talked on this podcast about how bad bans can be and how difficult it can be for new players to be like, oh my gosh, I just don't feel like I can even keep up with standard. Everything's getting banned all the time. Like I can never trust that anything I buy is even going to stick around. We know that those are concerns and they're real concerns, but also like standard was not in a good place. A lot of these formats were not in a good place. A lot of these formats, I mean, people kept making the joke of Pioneer being dead because like there was just... They didn't address these things that should have been banned for so long. So if they were going to do it, might as well just do it all at once. I think it's ripping the Band-Aid off.
So my other kind of, without going through each card individually, just my other top level question is, we saw, you know, Growth Spiral, Wilderness Wreck, Cauldron Familiar. These were all very essential cards and really made decks tick. Teferi Time Raveler, that card was oppressive in terms of holding back different strategies, but not dominant in the way, you know, some of these other cards were. So there's this whole discussion about, hey, was Teferi just banned because he's unfun? And let's just take that for a second. Like, let's assume that was true. Do you think that's a good reason to ban a card?
Yeah. I mean, Teferi's egregious because Teferi manages to turn... Teferi has a lot of, apart from being, I think, incredibly unfun to play against, Teferi also has all these weird ways that it interacts with other things. Like when cards come off suspend and you have a Teferi in play, you can't cast them because you would have to cast them at instant speed. So anything like that is gone. Teferi has almost every time something weird happened in a format and you couldn't figure out why it was, you just needed to look around to see if there was a Teferi in the board, because most of the times that answered your question. It was Teferi that was messing up whatever interaction. So I don't think there's anything wrong with banning a card because it's so incredibly unfun. Teferi is so incredibly unfun.
Yep. Teferi is a miserable, miserable card to play against, but I did a lot of it and then I built Bant and I started playing with Teferi and I was like, oh my God, this card's miserable to play with. Like, I really didn't have fun. And it's just not my style of
it's
Magic.
It's just not fun at all.
It's just like, and part of the reason was like, okay, hey, I'm going to win this game in 40 minutes. Like, it's just like, oh my, like, it took so long to do anything. He just threw the brakes on every game. And I was like, yeah, great, I'm going to win. But oh my, I don't want to anymore. I just want to go to the next game and play something else, you know?
It's not so good. And
I am all for, I know some people are like, hey, maybe Teferi didn't have to go. He wasn't that bad. I'm all for banning cards that are unfun. I really am. I think it's fine. So, the other major statement here, obviously, is Cauldron Familiar getting the ban. Because, look, Growth Spiral was going to be in for a bit too, wasn't it? Is Growth Spiral...
That's from the Ravnica sets.
Oh, it is? Okay. So really, it was just Cauldron Familiar that was going to keep going, right? Growth Spiral, Teferi, and...
That was an interesting thing about these bans is that most of the cards that got banned, except for Cauldron Familiar, were about to rotate soon. So it Wizards could have just waited and been like, hey, let's just wait until they rotate and those cards are going to be gone anyway. But I also think maybe things were bad enough. Maybe they felt like they really needed to just come in and like take some heavy action and ban all these cards and really shake up a format.
And I think it's exactly what they did. And I think they should get props for that. They should get some kudos here. Because the easier corporate line for them, without looking bad for R&D, is just to say, you know, it's like the dog, like everything's fine here, you know?
And it's going to rotate. Yeah, just with a cup and like the room behind the dog is just like lighting up on fire. Yeah.
Because they were almost there. They only needed to write it out for like, what, 6 more weeks?
Yes, you know? It wasn't that long. It was also just a matter of how much people have been complaining. And I do think there's a weird loop of people see that complaining gets things banned, so they complain more to get more things banned. And before like a couple of years ago, we were in a spot where there hadn't been standard bans in a really, really, really long time. When things were bad in standard, you just have to deal with them. And the metagame would try to adjust to correct for that. But it does feel like we're in this world where things are just getting banned more often. And if we do live in this world, I'd rather all these super unfun cards just go, even if they were about to go soon. Like, one of the things that Wizards did say in their announcement, which is interesting, is, hey, we're living in this COVID world where most of our events and most of the way that people play Magic is happening online. So there's no real reason, like, because we are living in this world, we're going to treat it more like a digital game. Like, we are going to make these changes more rapidly. And this is something you come to expect in other games like Hearthstone, because it's only digital. And so you see, like, balances and patches and things like that, or like Eternal, the card game, because they can't do that. If they say, like, hey, would it be better if Teferi just costed 4 mana, and would it be a lot worse? Yeah, maybe let's just bump up the cost and see what that does. And they can't really do it like that with Magic, but they can certainly ban the cards and see what happens to format when they do that.
Yeah, and I am glad they did that. I'm glad they're doing it, you know, because they got to eat a little crow. Obviously, we were all kind of frustrated with Growth Spiral and Wilderness Wreck and stuff like that. But like I said, they could... I think they'd already beaten us in a submission, right? Like, they really could have stood pat for the next few weeks, and we just would have been like, eh, okay, that it is what it is. And they didn't. So I think that's worthy of recognition. I'm going to give them kudos for that. I do think it was a good move. And do you have any other thoughts on standard?
Yeah. So something that was interesting about the way these bans happened is that there are no more big standard tournaments like in the future. There are going to be after, like, Zendikar Rising comes out. But there's nothing, like, it isn't like these changes kicked in because there's a historic, or excuse me, a standard open this weekend. Like, there isn't, that big tournament isn't coming at the moment. Which is interesting because a lot of times you have seen, like, one of the things that Wizards has historically done, especially with Modern, we've seen this with Modern a lot, there would have been a Modern Pro Tour coming up. And nothing had really changed in Modern because maybe none of the sets that they printed had anything that, like, really changed the metagame. So sometimes they would just go and take a look and say, like, okay, we're banning these and unbanning these and just let people, like, have
at
it.
Let's see what happens.
And honestly, those bans are kind of exciting because the people who are playing Modern are pretty entrenched players where card availability is less of a concern. And and you would just get to see a brand new format. That made the Pro Tour exciting because you knew these cards were gone, and then these other cards, what are the pros going to do with these other cards? Like, that's a cool thing. Since there's no standard tournament coming, it seems like Wizards just wanted people to be able to have more fun with the cards that they were playing, even with no incentive, which is interesting because we haven't really seen them do that much.
And I think this is a great, great move on their part. It's great signaling. And also the fact that, you know, I don't know how this affects Magic Online, but on Arena, you get your wild cards back. Do you get anything in Magic Online if stuff gets banned?
If you get banned on Magic Online, you're out of luck. You can sell the cards, but you can sell them for pennies, obviously.
Right. At that point, they've lost their value. So, I mean, that's the other thing I think that they should leverage is they know how many people are playing on Modo. They know how many people are playing on Arena specifically, where I get it. You get your wild cards for your, you know, your Wilderness Wreck back or your whatever. You put a lot more into that deck than just those, but you're getting something back. And I think that's important. I think that they need to leverage that more, where when they're making these bannings, they can actually offer directly the people impacted by those something. Not the whole thing, I get it, but something. And it's important that they do that. I think that that's another kind of lever they have here where they can feel a little bit better about banning some of these things.
Right. Also, some of these things, like if you get your wild cards banned, like if you get your growth spirals banned in standard, they're not banned in historic or whatever, like you still get to keep playing with those cards if you want, plus you get the wild card, so it doesn't really, you missed out on the rest of the cards that you crafted for that deck. But a lot of times, like, card availability is so easy on Arena that it's not that big a deal. Magic Online, definitely a different issue slash topic, but I think given that a lot of these bans are happening for standard, I think, and the majority of people playing standard on Arena, it does make it so that it's not as bad to ban.
So I had a wild idea, and I know we're coming up against it. I had a wild idea, and I'm probably going to talk to Martin about this on the Monday meta this week.
Okay.
And I know this is crazy. I know it. But And I have to look at the list of stuff. How would you feel, Gabby, if they were like, okay, the format's rotated. It's a whole new world now. So everything that's in that's still in standard that was banned is unbanned.
But I mean, that means standard rotated, so those cards wouldn't even be legal. What do you mean?
But Oko would be legal. Fires of Invention would be legal. Like the cards that stay are now unbanned in standard. Anything that was banned in the stats that survive rotation from the old standard are now unbanned in the new standard. Oko makes it crazy. Oko is the problem. I think that like that card's just busted.
Oh man, I think you just get such negative reception because I think when a card finally gets banned, you just get this like, oh, like a sigh of relief from so many people. And then I think if you just like put them back in the queue, people are like, no, I don't want to play against more Teferi. I don't want to play against more Cauldron Familiar. Like I saw this video from Bloody, who we had as a guest on MagicFM in the past. One of the things she talked about is, hey, I hated playing against Cauldron Familiar. I hated the play pattern. And, you know, she's been going through a thing where she's been kind of burnt out on Twitch and figuring out what she wants to do. She hasn't been streaming that much. But one of the updates that she provided was, hey, this makes me feel a lot better about playing standard because I hated playing against this card, right?
Sure.
So
sure.
Putting that stuff back in the mix makes me feel like the benefit you got out of banning the card, you're kind of like resetting it by throwing them back in the mix.
I think you're right. I think you're probably right. But it's just a novel idea of like, it's a whole new format now. Now, Familiar and Cauldron, they're both in and that would be a thing. I don't actually know. I mean, they held back a lot of aggressive creature strategy. So I am personally happy to see it's gone. But I just wondered like, the rotation is such a catastrophic change to the format. Like it is a whole new world, literally. And I wonder like that those things that were banned in the old world, Should they just make it a policy where it's like, they're going to drop back in. Hey, they're on a short leash. We already know there's a problem with some of these cards. Maybe not all of them would. Maybe you'd say, guys, gals, everyone, Oko ain't coming back. Like, let's get real for a second. Right? That was just a mistake.
Except for that one, especially that one.
yeah. And that, not Oko. But it was something I thought about, like, because it's going to be such a huge change. We don't know what's in Zendikar Rising that, you know, may interact with these cards positively or negatively. But it was just a random thought experiment I had the other day. I was thinking about it. So
yeah, no, that's interesting. Moving on to Pioneer. So the bans were Inverter of Truth, Underworld Breach, Kethi's The Hidden Hand, and Walking Ballista. And if you take a look at this roster of cards that got banned, you'll find something that they all share in common. They are all combo cards. These all were part of combo decks in Pioneer. And that is honestly one of the biggest criticisms that Pioneer's been getting lately is that, hey, every single deck in Pioneer is a combo deck. Like, where are your control decks? Where are your aggro decks? You can't really play them because everything you're playing is, you know, Inverter of Truth is a combo deck. Underworld Breach, combo deck. Kethi's a Hidden Hand, combo deck. Walking Ballista, also combo deck. Like, where...
Well. But I mean, I think Heliod's the real criminal there because Ballista saw play. I mean, all Inverter, Breach, and Kethi, you don't see that in anything but a combo deck. Ballista, you could see in other decks. It's just that Heliod combo deck is the problem. Right?
Yeah. So the thing that's weird with Ballista is as long as you can generate infinite mana, Ballista is always going to be one of the best answers you have to like put in your deck. Like if your deck makes infinite mana, Ballista is a good answer, right?
Sure. It's your colorless. Yeah, colorless.
Yes, it's colorless, answer. Goes into any deck, creates a kill immediately, basically. With infinite mana, it does. So I've seen a lot of criticism about like, well, why Ballista and not Heliod? And I honestly would have preferred, I think, to see Heliod banned because I think Ballista is like, I like Ballista. I think it's a cool card. It's a
fun card. Yeah.
But also, if they just feel like this might be a thing that continues to happen, it might just be the right decision to be like, okay, sorry, Ballista, like you had your fun. It's time for you to go. Whereas Heliod by itself is like not even really like that good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not like Heliod's going to see play anymore because Ballista's gone, and that's why you played Heliod. This is interesting because we never really know what goes into the secret sauce, like how the what gets banned sausage is made.
How the sausage gets made?
Yeah, because one of the things that was said the last time there was a ban posting is like the win percentage, I think, of like Inverter and Breach wasn't so high that they felt like. The Wizards felt like it was a problem in the format. But there's this whole other thing, which is Pioneer queues weren't launching. This is kind of what we talked about with Teferi, where at what point do you say, hey, okay, I get it. Maybe these decks aren't winning, but nobody's playing anymore because it's miserable to play against these decks. So now we've got to make a change. And it's, I, again, I'm clear on the side of yes, absolutely. If it's a miserable format to play, make a change. Even just if you don't think the win percentage is oppressive, yeah, just make it fun. Like, what's wrong with that? So I was happy to see this, and I assume you agree, like, that's okay. That's a fine place to make a decision.
Totally agree. I think the other thing that's interesting is this shows a little bit of where Wizards is at with Combo and Pioneer. It seems very clear by all the bans that they just took that they're not cool with it. They saw all of it. They kind of tried to let it run its course, see if maybe there were, like, I think they were waiting to see if that would correct. And it didn't. Mm-hmm. There's all these decks are popular decks that are very successful in Pioneer. And that's basically all you saw represented there. So they're like, okay, not anymore. Bam, 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 bam. And now with all these changes, a lot of different decks are going to pop up because, I mean, frankly, these bans are really aggressive. They did bans for like four different decks. But that also brings the question, what's this going to mean for decks, combo decks in the future in Pioneer? Like, is it the sort of thing where you should come to expect that if you have a very good combo deck in Pioneer is going to get banned?
Mm-hmm. No, so I think historically, I think Wizard's stance on combo's fine. Combo's okay. It's just how much time does it take for that combo to hit? There's like this weird sequence of how resilient is the combo? Can you disrupt it? And I think part of what they're waiting for with Pioneer is, hey, we think the format's going to find a way to disrupt these combos and make it okay. They were wrong. That wasn't going to happen.
That didn't happen.
These combos, the rest of the deck was resilient enough to fight through all of the hate. So that was part one. And then part two is how quickly can you hit the combo? Like, if it's a thing where you're getting combo killing people on turn two, turn three, there's just no way. Get it out of there, right? If it's turn six, turn five, turn six, turn seven, but there's enough disruption to really throw that out of whack, I think that's okay. Right.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen other combo decks that have been just popular in Modern forever that have never. I mean, Modern also has a lot of combo decks, but things like Ad Nauseam, which is not like it can reliably do its thing, but it's slow. It's a really slow deck. Like, it's never been at risk of having something banned because it's not. It's different when you have this deck that's really consistent in doing the thing every single game, really early in the game. And that's part of the reason that Twin was banned, right? Twin was just very consistent. You could get these turn four kills, and if you didn't, and it forced and it warped the way the entire format worked around it because you needed to have a way to answer, like a Splinter Twin. If you didn't, you were just dead.
Dead on the spot.
Yeah, you're dead on the spot. Turn four, dead. Yeah. And it wasn't even hard to do. So.
And it had a resiliency in the form of counter spells, control that it could put in there for free and like, stop you. So yeah, that's the other part of it. It's like, you know, any good combo deck can only goldfish somewhere around three or four, right? And get you, but there's another person playing and they should be able to disrupt you and stop you. So that's the big tell for me.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. So I think we're going to see some exciting changes in Pioneer because
you know,
so much stuff got banned and it does seem like it's going to be a lot less combo. I'm actually very much looking forward to seeing what happens with Pioneer because there was so much excitement when it first came out. And I think people got a little jaded because it was just all the same four decks or like all the same stuff.
Yeah.
All combo all the time. And I think people were like, I just don't even want to, the Pioneer queues weren't even firing. People just didn't want to play. So I think hopefully
crazy,
this will change that. Mm-hmm. Give it a little bit of a jump start. Then we had historic. And the two bans in Historic were Wilderness Wreck and Teferi Time Raveler. What do you think of these, Mosh?
Two suspensions.
Mm-hmm. Which once again, we've made it very clear that we think suspensions don't really make sense, but whatever, they're suspended.
Does not make any sense to me. You know what? I do think suspensions would make sense is if they weren't banned, but they were telling everybody out there, hey, these cards aren't banned, but we're watching them. So they could get banned at a moment's notice, but you've been warned. That's the only way I could see suspensions happening.
But once again, we've seen these cards that go, that skip suspended and go straight into ban. So like, what's the point?
You got to commit to something. And the only thing that I think has been suspended and not banned is Field of the Dead, right? They didn't end up banning Field of the Dead.
I think it came back, which, by the way, our of Promise is going to be an Amonkhet because that was a rare in Amonkhet. So Hour of Promise and Field of the Dead, that's not going to last long.
What is Hour of Promise to?
Let me read it all to you. It's 5 mana.
Amonkhet Remastered. By the way, Gabby, did you know, I don't think Amonkhet Remastered is going to be available for draft on Arena, is it?
It should be.
I didn't see it on the calendar.
Really? I was sure. I thought the whole point is that they were making it into a new draftable set.
I thought that was right, but I didn't see it on
we'll
there.
We'll have to check on that. I'm not 100% sure.
I started looking at the next quick draft format because it's TBD right now, and it's going to go back to core 2021.
All right. Listen to Hour of Promise and Pioneer. Historic. Are you ready?
Historic. Yeah, hit me.
5-mana sorcery. It's 4 colorless and a green. Search your library for up to 2 land cards, any land card. Put them onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle your library. Then if you control 3 or more deserts, which were the land type in Our Devastation.
Yeah.
And Amonkhet. Create 2/2 black zombie creature tokens. So this is tutor for Field of the Dead. That also makes zombies.
Wow.
Yep. If you control 3 or more deserts, which the deserts are now going to be available for you to play in those decks. The deserts are strong.
I play tons of Gruul, and I think Field of the Dead is very beatable. So I'm actually not that afraid of that deck, to be honest with you. I am excited to see what
I'm surprised to see them two together. I'm just saying. It's weird. I don't think it's going to last very long in the format if those two cards are in the format together. But basically, this means that there was no real action taken on Nexus.
No, there wasn't. And I mean, Wilderness Reclamation had to go. Because that was a very, very good deck in the format, and they needed to get rid of it. Teferi, I think, is definitely a casualty of being unfun. This is definitely just an unfun band. You didn't see a ton of Teferi.
It wasn't in a super popular deck. It was just like, okay, Teferi's gone, and he's gone for good. It was just gone everywhere.
Kethis, a lot of people, he wasn't a necessary component in Kethis, but also that deck is miserable.
That deck.
All right. Any final thoughts on the historic bannings? Nexus, really no action taken. But again, I'm not super afraid of that deck either. I just play Gruul all the time. And I think it's just an incredibly strong deck in that format.
No, I like the bans. I feel like, once again, I'm not pro banning everything all the time. But if all the formats were in a kind of bad spot and they're already going to clean up shop, I'd rather they just do it all at once, shake up the formats, and then let's see what happens here. And then maybe, hopefully, next time we don't have to do these like trickle bans where it seems like this thing gets banned this week, and then the next week something else gets banned, and the next week and one other card gets banned. I'd rather they just do it all at once.
Yep, agreed. Take that Band-Aid completely off. Mm-hmm. Then the healing can start. I love it. So... well, there you have it. We have two topics, two really good topics, though. Like, just not the bannings in the metagame, but just like the philosophy behind banning. And then, of course, you know, whether Wizards has predatory practices, but with the arena opens, but really just your relationship to gaming. We're all gamers, and always maintaining in all of our relationships, a healthy relationship is important. So that was a lot of fun. Thank you so much for joining us this week on Magic FM. Don't forget, we have our new code. It's code MagicFM. So if you join CFB Pro or make a purchase on Channel Fireball, be sure to put that MagicFM code in there to support this podcast. I appreciate it. Gabby appreciates it. We both appreciate it. Thank you so much. Until next week, you can find us on Twitter at MagicFM Podcast. You can find her at Gabby Spartz or twitch.tv/GabbySpartz. I am the guy on the left, Mashi Scanlon, at Mashi Scanlon across all social media platforms. Check us out. The video feed is on Channel Fireball. If you're listening to us, come see our beautiful faces. We'd love for you to join us. If you're listening to the podcast, hit subscribe. We appreciate that. Until next week, be wonderful to yourselves. Be wonderful to each other.
Bye-bye.